Dr. Ethel Tungohan, an associate professor of politics at York University. This is Academic Aunties. February is Valentine's Day month. So naturally, we're going to be talking about academic relationships. Last year, we had a great episode with Yasmin Abulaban and Abby Bakin about their friendship and the strengths of their professional and personal relationship. This year, we want to talk about the relationships academics have with our life partners. One thing we've observed is just how challenging it can be for academics and for their partners who have to contend with the limited job opportunities the academic job market provides. What are the negotiations that partners make when one partner gets a PhD admissions offer or a job offer? Is it easy to be in a romantic relationship with an academic, given academia's quirks? With us today to talk about navigating the relationship amid the absurdity of academia are my good friends, Suzanne and Tyler. And we also have my partner and producer of the podcast, Wayne. So before we begin, I'll have Suzanne and Tyler introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Suzanne Hindmarch, and I'm an associate professor of political science at UNB Fredericton. My pronouns are she, her, and I have known Wayne and Ethel since Ethel and I were in the PhD program at U of T, lo, these many years ago.
Hello, I'm Tyler Summers. I'm currently a master's student in civil engineering at UNB, and I've known Ethel and Wayne since Suzanne started her PhD program at U of T.
Yeah, that was 2006, right?
Yeah, 5 or 6.
And Wayne, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yeah, Wayne Chu, producer on Academic Aunties here and former PhD student. Didn't get through it, but we'll talk about that later, I'm sure.
So we're here today because we're talking about kind of academic partnerships and how academic relationships, romantic relationships work within this weird space that is the academy. So we thought we'd start by asking both of you, like, how did you meet? Did you meet when Suzanne was already on an academic track? Or, I mean, I know how you met, but like, let's keep this the PG-13 version. No, I'm kidding.
High school would probably be the quickest way to describe it. I mean, we were attending high schools that were within about 5 or 6 blocks of each other, and we had some friends in common, and that's how we first met.
Yeah, so we have known each other for quite a lot longer than we have been together as a couple, because we met when we were in our late teens, early 20s, and we both had a lot of dating dysfunctional, mediocre people to get out of our system. So we'd been friends for years before I actually moved back to Edmonton after finishing my master's degree for what I anticipated would just be a couple of months to see friends and family. And then I was planning to move away again and embark on, at that time, a professional career, not an academic career. But at that point, Tyler and I resumed our friendship, and then 20 odd years later, here we are.
That's beautiful. And at what point did both of you decide, Suzanne gets this offer from the University of Toronto to do her PhD in Toronto? What was the decision-making process like for both of you, to move here to Toronto? Pause.
we did discuss it. I was excited about it because it sounded like an interesting adventure going to Toronto. I mean, I'd always kind of wanted to experience a bigger city, so once I got there, there were some mixed feelings.
What did you think was going to be like? What were you expecting?
I had no preconceptions because I'd never known anyone pursuing graduate education, so I had no idea what I was getting into in terms of with the realities on the ground.
Yeah, and so you moved to this big city, both of you. I remember like your first apartment in Toronto where there were people having a lot of loud sex on the top floor, right?
I thought we were keeping this PG-13.
I mean, you know, we can talk about other people, not about ourselves. But like, so you move here and you've never been exposed to other people doing kind of higher learning, graduate degree. Was it kind of odd seeing your partner, Suzanne, in this new space, and she would come back with stories about academia? Like, what were kind of your initial reactions? Were you like, what is this world? So yeah, just talk to us about that.
It was sort of like there were two worlds, because there would be the Suzanne coming back home and talking about classes and the amount of work she has to do, But then there's a social aspect where a lot of the grad students would go out drinking together too. So I would always see like the fun socializing aspect of academia, but I was totally disconnected from the work side of things.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Suzanne, like, what was it like kind of? Usually it works in the reverse, right? Usually it's the dude leaving, like the in heterosexual partnerships leaving, and then the woman who follows. Like, what's it like kind of reversing the gender dynamics there a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, that's interesting. And I think, you know, when we talk about the tenure track offer and what that the gender dynamics of that were like, I think that is the point at which I noticed it more than the initial negotiation of moving across the country to grad school. Because I think for me, my experience had been, you know, I had parents who had both done grad school. I had lived and worked elsewhere in Canada and overseas. So for me, the move to Toronto was not, you know, it wasn't the first time I had lived away from Edmonton, which, you know, I guess we should say is our the hometown for both myself and Tyler. So there was a gender difference, but it's interesting hearing Tyler say that he was disconnected from, you know, the work stuff, because I think for me, that was the bigger adjustment, because I'd been a professional and I had worked in government and I had worked in NGOs and I had all of this non-academic experience and the norms of being in what most of us might think as sort of like a more normal professional work environment, and the norms of academia were very different. I remember when I first got the offer from U of T and I was communicating with the professor that I would eventually go on to TA for, and I addressed this professor in responding to the offer letter using that person's first name. And I found out later that that professor was quite taken aback and was offended that I had used the first name. And I mean, I was in my 30s and I was coming from a professional environment in government where, you know, we addressed very senior officials and government officials on a first name basis, even if we were at different points in the hierarchy. So there were a lot of weird norms to get used to in academia. And I'm not sure, I don't know if Tyler experienced the weird norms of academia in the same way, because I don't think that was as evident in the social aspect of things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think certainly Wayne, who now works for government, can see more clearly the dysfunctions of academia, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. I mean, I think sometimes it's a little bit triggering because I see what you're experiencing, Ethel, and, you know, you get frustrated and angry about that. And then I'm also remembering what I experienced too as well. So it's this kind of flashback as well. So, you know, the weird dysfunctions, all the things that you kind of accepted were normal. And, you know, I'm first generation, you know, graduate student. No one in my family had ever gone into a PhD. And then I get to government. It's like, oh, wow, this is really different. This is a lot more, you know, this is a lot nicer.
What are the dysfunctions? Because we're all kind of circling around it, but can you just name them just to make clear what we're talking about?
So one I will name, and I think this also relates to academic coupledom, is in academia, it is completely normal for work to take over your life, for there to not be evenings, not be weekends, the idea that there's always more work to be done and that you can and should be doing that work at all hours and be available at all hours. So that dysfunction, I think, starts when you're a grad student and you're expected to turn around TA shifts, TA grading assignments and stuff in sometimes unreasonable time frames, or the incredible pressure of cramming an entire canon into your head for the comprehensive exams, and the complete lack of work-life balance that is required to successfully navigate through a PhD and then navigate through the tenure track, and that is considered completely, totally normal to have absolutely no boundary between your work life and the rest of your life. And ideally, you know, your work life should be your life, and you know, the rest of your personal life kind of fit into the cracks and crevices around your real academic career.
No, it's interesting because, you know, Ethel and I met in the PhD program. Our relationship was born out of the PhD. We were both PhD students in the same program where we weren't doing exactly the same thing. But, you know, it's funny because there was no line between this is my work and this is my relationship. It was sort of all tied together. So I'm actually curious, Tyler, what, you know, how you were experiencing, what you were experiencing when, yeah, you were at these parties and people are talking about the work, because that's what we did when we were drunk. We're talking about the research and the work and these stupid debates over qualitative versus quantitative research. God. So yeah, what were your impressions?
You know, in some ways it was kind of normalized for me. At that time, I was working as a librarian for a law firm. So the work-life culture at Bay Street law firms is even worse than academia in many ways. So especially because I was working closely with generally the articling students or the first or second year associates. So seeing them put in 10-12 hour days was an entirely normal thing. So increasingly, I just got the impression that like for professional or academic jobs, that's just the way it was. And these are the expectations. And after a certain point, things get better. Because looking at how these supervisors worked and lived was very different from the grad students. So I was making the same parallels between the associates and the senior partners who have very different work-life balances and things that on their plate at any given time.
So can I just ask, and I'm just kind of using my friend prerogative here. So you both moved to Toronto. You had a prior relationship before you moved to Toronto. In contrast to me and Wayne, where our relationship began in grad school. And in fact, as a couple, we've had to learn how to create a space outside academia, especially after Wayne transitioned. Like, I remember there was a date we had at Sushi on Bloor where we were arguing about quantitative research. And then one of us walked out. It was so nerdy. It was so dumb. Like, why? Why? You know what I mean? Like, it's so, like, come on.
Yeah, no, you literally just turned the opposite direction, just walked down the street.
Yeah, I mean, about, like, research. I mean, geez, that's anyway. So like the dynamics are a little bit different and we've had to kind of get to know each other outside academia, especially as Wayne has left this dysfunctional world, right? I would venture to say that his workplace is more functional than my workspace. But for both of you, like, did the relationship shift? Because, you know, prior to that, you know, Suzanne was working like quote unquote a regular job and then she's immersed in this cult, right? Like this academic cult where... You know, I remember you saying when you were studying for comprehensive exams, like you would just kind of mutter the names of the people you had to remember. And it's kind of like you had post-it notes and you had to remember all of these like gods of like comparative politics IR. And it kind of, so I'm just kind of wondering, how did the boundaries of your relationship shift? And like, you know, how did you negotiate that as a couple?
How did Kenneth Waltz and the gods of IR destroy my relationships?
Like, I didn't feel like I was competing with these theorists for Suzanne's time. But I mean, there were extensive periods where I had to give Suzanne a lot of space and time to prepare for these comprehensive exams and then the peaks and troughs of
her work. Yeah, and I think, I mean, maybe this is retroactive imagining the good old days when everything was better. But I do think when we both were working full-time and in non-academic environments, I think we had a more consistently equal or equitable distribution of what was happening around the household and all of the other reproductive labor that, you know, the cooking, the cleaning, the house stuff that has to get done in order for a household and, you know, for a couple, for a family, for our lives to work. And I think definitely during the comprehensive exams and a lot of periods during the PhD and the tenure track slog as well, there have been a lot of periods of time where, you know, I was working 12 to 15 hour days, 7 days a week, and Tyler was picking up a lot more of, you know, all of preparing meals, you know, keeping the house clean, you know, walking the dog. So I think there was definitely a shift and a renegotiation of labor. And I think that is also a place where typically, you know, the typical academic couple is a couple where the man is the academic and has a wife who might not be, you know, full-time stay-at-home mother and wife, particularly these days. But I think academia is still predicated on that model of an academic relationship where it's assumed that you have a spouse at home who's doing all of that invisible labor for you.
Did other people understand that? And I'm thinking about when Ethel did her postdoc at the University of Alberta. I mean, I was working at the time. I was out of the PhD program. I had this, you know, just started this really great job. And, you know, she left for Edmonton for 2 years. And I remember people, you know, family members, others being like, wow, you're so great. How can you like let her do that? And it was like, well, that's the academic life, right? But it's just sort of these norms that are, it's like in these gendered norms about how, wow, this is like a sacrifice that, you know, that I'm making. And I'm wondering, did people understand that from your perspective?
Yeah. So I think, I mean, first of all, I think our families still don't entirely understand the rhythms of academia and will consistently ask, you know, what are you doing for Easter or for Thanksgiving, which are two of the busiest times of the academic year because it's right before midterm exams and right before the end of semester. And we'll still, my parents will still be consistently surprised that we're not hosting, you know, a big Easter dinner for 25 of our closest friends who are also academics at one of the busiest times in the academic calendar. So I think just generally, that world is completely opaque to people who aren't in it. But in terms of the gender dynamics specifically, I have had quite a lot of self-professed feminist men tell me how amazingly lucky I am that I have stumbled on this fantastic unicorn of a partner who was amazingly willing to put his own career aside and to move for me and to give up so much for me. And to a certain extent, that is true. Tyler has made a lot of sacrifices in his career to accommodate mine. But those are not people who I think have the same perspective that their wives have been amazingly self-sacrificing and unusually, you know, exceptionally accommodating, because they cannot imagine a world in which their careers and their needs did not always come first. So I think there definitely is a gender dynamic in terms of how surprised and how, you know, as you were saying, Wayne, you know, how surprised people are that you know, that Tyler would let me do this to him. I don't know if you've had any conversations or reactions along those lines.
Yeah, this has come up. If I'm working with the same people a lot, my partner comes up, what she does, what I do. And when they find out that I moved here because of her job or these sort of things, like they never say anything. But there's definitely a beat and a pause in the conversation. Well, they want to say something, but they don't, because I can see that either they have questions or they want to comment on, you know, frankly, who's wearing the pants. But
in some ways, it's lucky because of this exceptionally low bar that I have to clear. Because I'm thinking about, you're talking about how saying to Ethel, you're so lucky, your partner lets you go. But I also actually didn't actually move to Edmonton. I mean, I know folks who, like, the expectation, you know, is that their partner just moves without question. I remember, Ethel, you saying when you were on the job market saying, you know, what about Kalamazoo? It's like, no, I'm not moving there.
Yeah, for sure. And I think what's interesting is that we were both, I mean, Wayne was aware of what the academic market's like because he was in the PhD program. And he knows that when we make plans, it's in like 3 to 5 year increments, right? And he knows that, you know, it wouldn't make sense for both of us for you to give up your permanent, you know, full-time job.
Government job.
Government job with benefits to follow me to a 2-year temporary postdoc, right? Yeah. But at face value, I think a lot of the gender stereotypes are interesting. I mean, I think even some of my relatives have counseled me and they say, you know, honestly, some women will probably try to sleep with Wayne, right? They'll probably try to steal him because you're not there. And like, this was like really well-meaning advice. And they're like, you know, and so I was getting a lot of pushback. And in some ways, I mean, you're kind of being construed as this, like, I don't know, this sap who like lets this ball buster do what she wants. When really it was like a decision we made out of, you know, a sense of what the market, the academic job market's like. So, you know, these are the stereotypes we do have to fight against. And I'm curious to see for both of you, I mean, have you had like family members being like, you know, not saying anything, but kind of side-eyeing you and being like, is this really like what you have to do to kind of pursue, help Suzanne pursue the academic career?
I think, yeah, nothing I could ever like call anyone out on. Because
they're not listening to the podcast.
So they're yeah. But no, I think they have some questions sometimes, but they're never going to be rude and direct about it. But I think the idea of yeah, me uprooting my life, not once, but twice to move to a different city for Suzanne's career. It's just outside the experience of everyone in my family to date. So not side-eyed maybe, but just like they don't, on a very basic level, get it. Like, why? Why is this happening? Why can't she find something closer to home?
Yeah, why can't you just get a job at the University of Alberta, Suzanne? Like, sure. Why are you going to New Brunswick, for goodness sake?
Yeah, and I think, again, that relates to, you know, what I was saying earlier about just academia and the weirdness of academia and how the academic job market works is completely opaque to anyone who's not in it, because it's so unusual. There is no other profession. I mean, maybe pro sports that works in this way, where people have no, you go where the jobs are and you really have very little choice in if you want to pursue this profession, if you want to pursue this career, you're constrained. And I think, you know, we should also acknowledge that, I mean, Tyler and I have a ton of privilege. So, you know, because we are both white, because we are in a heterosexual relationship, because we have class privilege, we have all of these forms of privilege that made it a bit easier for us to envision living in a lot of places that would certainly not be as welcoming for a racialized couple or for a queer couple. So, and also to, you know, a place where, because of Tyler's career, he is still going to be able to find work in his field in a way that might not have been possible, you know, in some other cities. So I think that's also where there's all of these other structures and systems pressures and, you know, patriarchy and heteronormativity and you know, all of these gendered, racialized structures and forces that shape what becomes possible or not for academic couples, depending on who those academic couples are.
That's such an important point. I think it reminds me of a friend of mine who got a job offer in a country that doesn't actually recognize same-sex marriage. And ultimately, this friend decided, no, of course not. But like, the job market is such that was one of the only jobs that they were able to get, right? So this is a useful and important reminder of how these decisions are also constrained by these structural inequities. Let's talk about New Brunswick. So this is the second time that you've moved, both of you have moved to pursue kind of Suzanne's career. What was that like? And what was the negotiation process like with UNB? Was this something that was easy?
Well, I mean, I will say generally that I think universities, especially smaller universities, do not do well in terms of accommodating academic spouses, whether those spouses are themselves academics or, you know, have professions and careers outside of academia. I think the university as an institution still doesn't know what to do with spouses. And even the way that we talk about it, you know, we talk about the quote unquote two-body problem as if the ideal academic is someone who should not have that second body as a problem. And the fact that you know, you're a couple, there's two of you, is a problem, because it means that you're not completely independent, completely flexible, completely able to relocate anywhere and devote all your time and attention and focus to your academic career. So that's also one of the dysfunctions of academia. So I think generally, universities don't know and don't have the institutional supports in place to support academic spouses.
Tyler, what's it like for you? So I was hanging out with a friend who has a partner who also moved for their job. And one of the hardest things this partner had expressed was that, at least initially, their social circles are their spouses, like department members. And it's just hard, right, to kind of find your own social rhythms, especially in spaces where it's probably like the social circles aren't that big, right? So you're kind of stuck being friends with your partner's coworkers, but that in itself is also a little bit awkward sometimes, especially since they're not just coworkers. They're also people who potentially evaluate your partner too. So like, what's that process been like for you?
I think that has been one of the more difficult things to negotiate, is just the shrinking of social circles every time we move, and then trying to break out of Suzanne's social circle to find my own. This last time to Fredericton, because I was a student again at that point, I sort of had a pre-built social circle of engineering colleagues. So that was helpful in some ways, but also kind of alienating in others, because all of these students, they're undergrad engineering students, they're all half my age now. So we were acquaintances and colleagues that we can get along to various degrees or another, but we're never really going to be like close friends. I mean, I had more than a couple of the students say that I remind them of their dads.
Oh my God.
So like once that comes out, that's a barrier to friendship that is never going to be overcome again. Yeah, that's been difficult. And I think once I'm back to working full time again, I'll be able to sort of explore the whole work friend situation and sort of create a social identity that is separate and apart from Suzanne. Because, yeah, it is hard, especially when these social gatherings with Suzanne and her work colleagues, 50 to 60% of the conversation will always be about the department politics, what's going on, while the other partners sort of either we go off into a different room or we sort of look on helplessly as the conversation just goes elsewhere.
I will say, though, I remember the many times that we would be at a bar having a beer, and it was nice to have you around to be able to, as we're, you know, talking about something or complaining about something, for you to say, that is really fucked up, because you're not enmeshed in that world.
Yeah, I think a bit of reality check is good too, because I think there are a lot of really dysfunctional things that are tolerated in academia that are just not okay in the private sphere.
Like what? Can you talk about that?
At length. I mean, so when they're PhD students, I think there was a lot of bad personalities as supervisors that I was hearing about all the time.
Wayne might have something to say.
Oh my God. You know what? He was an asshole. Anyone who listens to the podcast, Wayne's PhD supervisor was an asshole.
Sure. And I just like literally abusive people. Like I don't, that is not okay. And it would not be tolerated in most other professional environments. And in terms of department politics, I think there are some people that just don't engage with tasks that need to be done in ways that, again, just would not be tolerated in another environment. Like, you can't just like opt out of doing parts of your job. That's not okay.
I think Wayne has a lot to say about that. Sweetie, do you want to, like...
It's probably a topic for another podcast.
But, like, yeah, no, I mean, I think that's the point, right? Like, it's like, you know, you have partners who aren't in academia, who kind of listen to your friends in academia talk about it, who in some cases listen in on department meetings, because during COVID, a lot of this was virtual. And, you know, Wayne would just sometimes shake his head at me and be like, what's going on? Like, why is this still happening? Why are you, this meeting has gone on for like 2 hours, but no decisions have been made.
And you listen, it's just a circular argument, and it's about theory, and it's about these like abstract esoteric arguments, when really you're just trying to figure out like whether to send an email or, you know, some sort of minutia of administration, which should have been an email itself.
Suzanne, do you have anything to say about kind of exposing Tyler to these like messed up dynamics?
Yeah. I'm trying to think what I can say that I'm actually comfortable okay, with on the podcast.
I think, you know, we can just say that there are definitely non-academic norms that, you know, in academia, just we don't follow them because it's so dysfunctional. So even what Tyler was saying, right, with respect to supervision, right? Like your supervisor almost becomes like your kind of, it's not even a supervisor in the workplace sense, right? Like your supervisor dictates your future. Your supervisors, it's almost like a feudal relationship, right?
Yeah.
So,
and I think it's also, you know, that exists on the tenure track too, in not quite to the same extent, but when you are pre-tenure, one does need to be mindful of those who are tenured and in a structural position of power, who are going to be reviewing your tenure file and are going to be making decisions not necessarily overtly, explicitly blocking a path towards tenure, but there's a lot of just, subtle ways that a path through academia can be made easier or harder. I, and I think Tyler too, in social interactions with senior colleagues, whether that's in the department or more senior administrators, there's always, at least for me, in the back of my mind, pre-tenure, there was always these are people who have structural power over you, and you need to be careful and cautious in those interactions.
For sure. I think it's a profession that relies on us always owing someone something. Do you know what I mean? And it's not about even an assessment of your qualifications. There's always something, it's so power laden in a way that other professions are not, right? And I think that's the perfect note to actually wrap up this conversation. I mean, for listeners who are part of relationships, who are part of these negotiation processes, what advice can you give PhD students, early career academics who are trying to navigate, these partnership dynamics, whether it involves people who are considering taking up a job, but their partner doesn't necessarily, want to move? Like, what advice would you give folks?
I mean, I guess I would say that there is a lot that is dysfunctional and that is not okay. But I think also that a good relationship, a good, equitable, solid, loving relationship and partnership can be one of the really important protective things that can help us, manage and thrive in academia. And I think, Richard Eyton has had this great passage in his book that someone who's been a guest on this podcast, Deb Thompson, posts every year around Valentine's Day about the subversive power of love and about the power of love to, as a form of solidarity in what can sometimes be a challenging environment. So seek out those partnerships, seek out those relationships, but also recognize that there's a lot that's institutionally not okay, that institutions need to support spousal hires. They need to support paid leave for people who may need to care for a family member. They need to support, during the hiring process, support the non-academic spouses and facilitate conversations about what's available for non-academic spouses. So I would say, there's some collective action that we need to do to transform those structures.
That's awesome. Tyler?
Tyler, do you have any advice?
I guess if you're negotiating someone who is entering a PhD program or is now on the job market, the partner really needs to prepare themselves. They need to be flexible in terms of location and preparing for either looking for work or whatever they do ahead of time, but also be prepared to take on some of these extra tasks around the house, or just understand that the relationship's going to be a little bit unequitable for a little while as things get settled into this new job, because there is no flexibility there, and there are just non-negotiable deadlines and things that need to get done for the beginning of the term or whatever preparation work needs to be done. So
can I flip the tables too and ask Ethel, Wayne, what advice do you two have?
Wayne,
I would actually echo what you guys have been saying in terms of, there's the structural issues and the fucked up, norms, but when you're in the thick of it, having that understanding of what your partner is up against is really important. I think having had that experience in academia has helped me at least withstand some of the low moments, that any relationship has, to, remind myself, I'm upset or I'm feeling resentful or I'm feeling whatever, but this is not Ethel's fault. This is what she's up against. And just to have that kind of reminder is important as well. But, I would also say too, there's something very, I'm not saying it's a good thing, but there's in that kind of, those kind of dire straits, it's very clarifying whether your partner and you are on the same page, when you're in the fire there, right? because I don't want to give the impression that, oh, you know, the secret success is that you have, you know, a successful partnership or you get married or you have kids or whatever, which, you know, there are things that we've done, but, you know, like, you know, if your partner, and I'm thinking about the norms and expectations, if your partner isn't on board with that, you know, then that's okay to recognize that, you know, this is an important part of your life. It's not necessarily a calling, but it might feel a little bit like a calling. And that's important too. This heteronormative norm of having a successful relationship is not something you have to strive for.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. I think having someone be my partner in all of this, be my partner as I faced a bunch of different academic challenges, such as, you know, my department forgetting to send up my tenure file, which was, you know, really quite a punch in the face, right? And having Wayne there and being supportive, that allowed me to kind of go through these challenges because I wasn't by myself, but also recognizing that ultimately, what is a perfect partnership anyway, right? Like, you know, and kind of relinquishing this notion of a perfect marriage or a perfect partnership and recognizing that we're all just doing the best we can, right? Which, I don't know. I mean, that's not overly prescriptive, but also kind of fighting for the structural changes that Suzanne was getting at as well. Like, what institutionally can we do to accommodate families, right? Not just partners, but families themselves.
So. Yeah, no, I'm thinking too about, you know, in a previous episode where Harshita Yalamardi was saying, you know, as PhD students, you're often the top of your class. You're sort of used to being the shiny object or the teacher's pet. And you need to you need to achieve everything and check all the boxes and like being successful in life. But you know, you don't have to.
I know. Sometimes Wayne gets mad at me because he's like, I'm not your qualitative research project. Sometimes I have an internal checklist where I'm like, okay, done with my book, students, children are in bed. I turn to Wayne and I'm like, okay, how was your day? Let me know. And I've kind of put on this like interviewer affect as though he's like part of my focus groups. And then Wayne's like, can you just watch, you know, Dairy Girls? Like, why are you like pivoting? And I'm like, right, because I have this internal checklist trying to kind of be the perfect professor, be the perfect mother, be the perfect partner. And he's like, stop. I don't know if you both have that dynamic.
Yeah, I think sometimes negotiating the whole fitting and talking around the edges while Suzanne's trying to get other things done does occur, but I don't know if it's... I've never felt like a project. That's an interesting perspective.
So my project building has been successful.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah.
Well, thank you both so much. This was a lot of fun, and I think our listeners will get a lot out of this conversation.
Thank you. It was lots of fun to talk about this with you, and thank you again for inviting us on the podcast.
Remember, listeners, that academia is not set up for couples. It is designed with the belief that individuals are mobile without caring responsibilities, and that anyone who chooses otherwise, who tries to, say, get a spousal hire or even decides to reject job offers if the move wouldn't be good for their partners and their families, isn't really serious about their jobs. In Academic Aunties, we resist these assumptions. These are outdated and deeply gendered ways of thinking. So as always, do what's right for you and for your partner and your families. And structurally, let's fight for ways to make the academy more accommodating for partners and families. And that's Academic Aunties. You can follow us on Twitter at Academic Auntie. If you use Mastodon, find us at academicaunties@maz.to. Prefer email? You can message us at podcasts@academicaunties.com. And finally, visit academicaunties.com/support to find out how to support this podcast. This includes becoming a Patreon supporter, which goes right into supporting our production costs. Today's episode of Academic Aunties was hosted by me, Dr. Ethel Tungohan, and produced by myself, Wayne Shu, and Dr. Nisha Nath. Tune in next time when we talk to more Academic Aunties. Until then, take care, be kind to yourself, and don't be an asshole.